It's easy to think that God would love us more if we were perfect. You know, if we never sinned, if we never messed up. I think it's even the logical thing for us to think. We know that because God is holy, he can't look at evil. He can't even be in the same vicinity as evil. We're told that faith without works is dead. And we even see in Scripture that a life that's impacted by the gospel should be transformed by the gospel. Does the transformative power of the gospel make us perfect? It doesn't look like it. I have yet to see a perfect Christian. I don't know about you, but I've never succeeded in being perfect myself. I've never really been able to make it work. And in my mind, I tend to think that if I could just try a little harder, if I could just not be sinful, maybe the people in my life would like me more than they do. Maybe people would like me more if I were a better person. And I feel really sure that God would love me more if I were a better person. If only I could be perfect. Maybe you felt this way. Maybe you've even felt this way as we've been going through this series on the seven letters. You wish you could be sinless, but when you look at these letters, it starts to feel like maybe I've abandoned my first love like Ephesus. Maybe I've shrunk from challenges and persecution, and I haven't held up Jesus' name like Smyrna did. Maybe in the case of Pergamum, maybe I've compromised with culture. Maybe I've allowed the culture to enter my life like Thyatira. And maybe there are parts of your life that you thought were alive, but they're really dead, like Sardis. But we've said it so many times, Jesus, he is being pastoral here in these letters. He's being comforting. He is trying to discipline those who he loves. You've heard it said that God is a good, good father. And that's true. But God also says this in Proverbs 13:24, whoever spares the rod hates his son, but he who loves him is diligent to discipline him. He also says this in Revelation chapter 3, verse 19, those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline, so be earnest and repent. Even though God has been bringing corrections to these churches, he's loving them, pastoring them, acknowledging their accomplishments and achievements along with their shortcomings. Jesus is being pastoral. And we've said this often, but it's easy to forget, because when the word revelation comes up, it conjures up these images of fire and brimstone and dragons and weeping and gnashing of teeth. But remember, God disciplines those whom he loves. So don't be envious of perfection. Perfection is reserved for God. Don't expect to be perfect, because you can't be. You won't be. And God still loves you despite your imperfection. He still loves you when he's correcting you and making you into his image. I'm not telling you to sin so that grace may abound, but I'm telling you that God isn't searching for a perfect people to advance his kingdom. He's searching for a true people to advance his kingdom. We're going to talk about what it means to be true today, and a little bit about what it means to be a faithful church as we arrive on our sixth letter in Revelation, the letter to the church in Philadelphia, known as the faithful church. Now, don't shut me off. Don't tune me out. I know I've talked about faithfulness like the past two sermons, okay? I know that. This one's going to be different. I mean, you can blame Pastor Jeff and you can blame the staff for this kind of poor planning. I definitely didn't have anything to do with that. Of course, I'm kidding. I'm excited about this message. Don't blame anybody. You really shouldn't be blaming, especially Pastor Jeff, because you should be praying for our pastor. You may be wondering why I'm preaching here today, and a huge part of that is that actually Pastor Jeff and Anna are traveling. They're in Europe ministering to our sister churches, the churches that they helped plant in Poland and Ukraine, and they're ministering to and loving on the people who have been affected by this war. So please keep our pastors in your prayers and be praying for their success and their safe return home. But here we go. We're going to be reading the whole letter to Philadelphia, and we're going to stop and make some comments about what this letter means, how we should read it in the context of the time that it was written in, and a little bit of the context of the modern church today. So Revelation chapter 3, verses 7 through 13 says this: "And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write the words of the Holy One, the true one, who has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, who shuts and no one opens. I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door, which no one is able to shut. I know that you have but little power, and yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. Behold, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say that they are Jews and are not, but lie, behold, I will make them come and bow down before your feet. And they will learn that I have loved you. Because you have kept my word about patient endurance, I will keep you from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world to try those who dwell on the earth. I am coming soon. Hold fast what you have so that no one may seize your crown. The one who conquers, I will make him a pillar in the temple of God. Never shall he go out of it, and I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down from my God out of heaven, and my own name. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." Now, did you notice any corrections? Any judgments, any reproof, any discipline for these people that God loves? I didn't. How interesting is this? Like the church in Smyrna, there's no reproof for the church in Philadelphia. Unlike Smyrna, though, there's not even any bad news. There's no bad news at all for this church. It's all gospel. It's all good news and congratulations. This almost reads like a well done, good and faithful servant. They've got congratulations. God says that he knows their works, that they've kept his word. They haven't denied his name. They've patiently endured. He cautions them to hold fast so that no one will seize their crown, which means that he's already got a crown prepared for them. They've already got a crown waiting for them. He even gives them a promise because they're on par to finish the race. He promises them that the Jews who lie but are actually a synagogue of Satan will bow down at their feet. It's a promise of victory, of triumph for this church that has been faithfully persevering and fighting the good fight of faith. We'll talk a little bit about this victory in, you know, a later portion of this message because it's beautiful. But right now I want to let you know that he promises them protection from an unknown calamity that's going to envelop the world. And I'm not going to talk really about that unknown calamity. I mostly want to talk about the faithfulness, the goodness, and the trueness of this church, and how we can apply that to our lives. See, he tells them that they will be pillars in the temple of God, that he will write on them a new name, the name of God and the city of God in his own new name. This is good news. This is triumph. This is well done, if I've ever heard it. And you know what? We kind of needed it. We kind of needed some good news because a lot of this series has been filled, even though it is pastoral, it's been sort of filled with failures. We've heard a lot of, "but I have this against yous." We've heard a lot of that. I want to look back on where we've come from because we're far enough along in the series that I can do that. And I want to see the beauty in this series of letters. Ephesus abandoned their first love. Smyrna would face persecution. Pergamum was compromising with the culture. Thyatira allowed the culture to enter the church. Sardis, we have death. Philadelphia, we have well done. And in Laodicea, which, spoiler alert, that's next week, it's detestable. God will vomit it out of his mouth. I don't know if you've noticed this progression, sort of this pattern here. I'm really excited to talk about it. But the progression starts in Ephesus. It skips Smyrna. It skips Philadelphia. So the second church and the second to last church skip this pattern. But the rest of the churches sort of have this decline. And I think when we look at it from a bird's eye view, you can see how even churches today could follow this pattern of decline in our spiritual effectiveness. First, a church abandons its love for God. It abandons the deeds it did at first. It's lost perspective while running the race and has begun to focus on its own agenda and ideals. Then in Pergamum, we see that the church has begun to compromise. It's weak to outside influence. The church is beginning to decline in its principles and stances. And then the next church, it allows the culture to enter it. It begins promoting false teachings and even allows immorality within the confines of the community. As we saw in Sardis last week, the church's name dies. Its influence on the outside culture is all but gone. God's church becomes a church in name only and ceases to advance the kingdom. We get that break in Philadelphia, where we are now. But next week, you'll see a church that has become so disgusting, so detestable to God, that he threatens to vomit them out of his mouth. The church is made up of people, broken people, damaged people. And I think that we can apply this overarching patterns not just to our churches, but to our own lives. So ask yourself, where am I? Am I just now losing the love that I first had? Am I compromising with the culture, allowing myself to be dominated by the culture? Am I dead spiritually? Hopefully not. I hope we get to look at Philadelphia and be encouraged, hold on to promises and praises that God had for his true and faithful church. God starts off his letter to this church by calling himself the Holy One. And if you've been here for the series, you know that how God introduces himself is always pretty important. He calls himself the Holy One, the True One. And this is really exciting for me. We're going back to sort of Old Testament language, Old Testament talk. God is saying that he's holy. Did you know that the word holy is actually used 90 times in Leviticus? I didn't know that. I figured that out while I was writing this message. But what God is doing here is reminding the church of his divinity. Yes, this is Jesus talking, the God who became a man, the one who can sympathize with our weakness, but this is also straight up God, the perfect one, the holy one, the name above all names, the one who can't tolerate evil. And this God, the holy and true entity beyond anything we can even fathom, he has no correction for this church? What? How can this be? How was Philadelphia a perfect church? Well, no. I mean, that can't be right. Churches are made up of people, and no one is perfect. Romans chapter 3, verse 23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." But do you realize how amazing this is? Do you realize what I've been leading up to this entire sermon from the beginning, asking, you know, if only I could be perfect? And now we're here. God, who is perfect, has no condemnation, has no reproof for this church. This church with a little power pleased God. By the way, when he says a little power, it's more than likely that that means that this was a small church. They were probably small in comparison to some of the other churches in Asia Minor, but he was happy with them. They did well. They were full of broken hearts, broken people, sinful people, but because they clung to Jesus' name, Jesus saw a faithful and true people. God the Father sees his Son, Jesus Christ, in this church. They held fast to the teachings and the word of Christ. And so God the Father sees a redeemed people in the church of Philadelphia. I don't know why this is so huge for me, but this just tells me that we can be great as disciples of Jesus. We can be great together as a body of believers in this life. We can run the race and we can experience the fullness of God's promises and blessings on us as a community, not just as individual people, but as a community. Maybe this is obvious to you. Maybe you don't really get why I'm freaking out over this, but come on, we've been hearing failure after failure for these churches, but the faithful one, the holy one, the true one has no reproof, no correction for Philadelphia. Church, I think we can have that. And I think that's why I'm so excited. The fact that one church did it, one church was filled with the presence of God and had no room for correction from Christ, tells me we can be great. We can be faithful. We can be a faithful church. I think we can aspire to be the ones who serve our communities, both physically and spiritually. That's what it means to be great, to be a servant. This is good news. I don't care what anyone says. It's good news. Faithful churches exist. And that tells me that when we come together and we don't deny Jesus, when we stand for truth, that we become stronger as a community. This passage, just his introduction, strengthens my resolve and my faith to be part of the local church, because Jesus sees the local church. He sees us, Manna Church. He sees us, and in our new identity as God's church, nothing can stand against us. Romans chapter 8, verses 33 through 35 says, "Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword?" That's a question. And the answer to that question is no. Nothing can stand in the way of God and his love for this church. But I think there's revelation in this letter. I mean, obviously, it's called Revelation, but there's revelation in all of these letters. There's such a concentration in our Western American Christianity and our culture that we really put so much emphasis on our personal walks with Christ. We think to ourselves, how am I going to measure up when I get to the judgment seat? How am I going to do? Is he going to say to me, "Well done, good and faithful servant"? Have I used my talents well? Did I activate my own individual purposes and callings in this life? And all of that's very legitimate. These are great questions, and we should ponder them and think on them. I believe that we should be concerned with our personal impact on our world. And this might sound very familiar to you. This might even sound like growth track. And in a lot of ways, it is. We at Manna Church believe it's our mission to equip God's people to change their world. But if there's one thing that we have learned from Revelation, I think it should be that God evaluates us on our churches. Not how good the worship is or how inspiring the preaching is, but on the richness of our communities, on our resolve to remain counterculture, to bring a people, to be a people that is in the world and not of it. A people. Plural. God isn't searching for a single true worshiper. He is searching for worshipers. That's plural. Again, that's plural. Who will worship in spirit and in truth. And can I add again, one more time, that's plural. He is searching for a true people, not a true person. God tells the other churches in Revelation that some of the people they're not holding to false teachings. They're doing a good job. You know, that many of them are doing great things. They're not partaking in false teachings. They're not eating food sacrificed to idols. They're not committing sexual immorality. But while God doesn't discount the faithful members of a church, he is rebuking and judging the churches as a whole, as a single entity. I don't know about you, but this tells me that it's not nearly enough to be a Christian. It's not enough. God told us he would build his church and the gates of hell would not prevail. The church isn't one person. It's not you. It's us. God is telling this church in Revelation now about a different kind of gate. You know, Jesus said that the gates of hell would not prevail, but we're talking about a different kind of gate. We're talking about keys and doors and David and stuff. So let's look at that. Because Jesus says he has the key of David. He opens and no one will shut, and he shuts and no one opens. This city in Philadelphia actually had an important passage through the mountains. It was considered the keeper or the key to the Eastern Highlands. So this church is addressed by God, the one who says that he holds the key of David. Despite the prestige of this city and its location, God is reminding the church in this city that it is responsible for a far more important door and that they have access to far more important keys than the keys and doors that we find in this life. He also tells them that he holds the key of David, and I've said that a couple of times. There is only one other verse in the Bible that I've been able to find that makes this same reference, and it's in the Old Testament. So we need some context here. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 22, verses 15 through 22. I'm going to stop at some points, so, you know, grab your Bible, keep it out so that you can look at this. I think it's really important to see this Bible in whatever version of the Bible you like to read, but if you don't have a Bible with you, it'll be on the screen. So starting at verse 15, it says this, "Thus says the Lord God of hosts, come, go to this steward, to Shebna," that's a person, "who is over the household, and say to him, what have you to do here? And whom have you here that you have cut out here a tomb for yourself? You who cut out a tomb on the height and carve a dwelling for yourself in the rock." Now understand, this steward that God is getting to address here, he's getting ready to address him with pretty violent language. This guy was a treasurer. He was trusted with great wealth and abundance, and he used the resources of his kingdom to make for himself a dwelling place and a lofty tomb. Maybe this makes you think of the parable of the talents. That's what I was thinking of. Shebna was given many talents to steward, and he used them for himself. He was trusted with the blessings and resources of the kingdom, and he poured them out lavishly all over himself. Let me put it this way. He was given kingdom resources, and he used those kingdom resources on himself. How does the Lord react? Verse 17, "Behold, the Lord will hurl you away violently, O you strong man. He will seize firm hold on you and whirl you around and around and throw you like a ball into a wide land. There you shall die, and there shall be your glorious chariots, you shame of your master's house. I will thrust you from your office, and you will be pulled down from your station." Now this is not good news for this steward. But this is where it really starts to parallel the parable of the talents, don't you think? Do you remember what happened to the man who hid the one talent away? Well, if you don't, I'm going to remind you. We're going to jump out of Isaiah, jump into Matthew chapter 25, and we're going to read this scripture as well. This is verses 24 through 30, and it tells us the end of this parable of the talents. "He also, who had received the one talent, came forward saying, 'Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talents in the ground. Here, you have what is yours.' But his master answered him, 'You wicked and slothful servant. You knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.'" Wow. It seems that stewardship is really important to God. I think oftentimes we look at these passages and we think about our finances. We think about our money and how we steward the literal financial resources that God has given us. And there is certainly something to that. But allow me to take this passage way too literally for just a moment. Talent. You have talents. This master in the story gave talents away to his servant, to his servants. Most of his servants used their talents and they multiplied them. One servant hid his talent away. He never shared it. He never took any risks with it. He kept it all to himself. He hid it in the ground. He hid it under a bushel. He never let it shine for anyone else to see. He never brought his talent out in the open to bless anyone else with it. Now, I'm going to try to use myself as an example here, and I don't think I'd do a great job of using myself as an example, but I'm going to try. I'm a musician, and I'm one of the worship leaders here at Manna Church. I like to sing, and I like to play guitar, and I like to pretend that I can play piano, although I really can't, if I'm being honest. I like to do those things, and I think I'm okay at them. I certainly do a good enough job to not have people boo me off of a stage if I'm playing somewhere. Now, God has blessed me with those talents. Every good thing, every true thing that I have comes directly from the Father. Now, I try to use those talents to bless the community, to bless the church. That's why I serve here on the worship team. But if I knew I had those talents, if I knew that God had blessed me, that he had given me talents essentially for free, and I chose to only use them for myself, that becomes an issue. So, like, let's say that I enjoy playing guitar and I love singing, but I never use it for other people. I never use it to edify the body of Christ. I just do it whenever I'm feeling particularly stressed out and I want to encounter God in my home. Let's say that maybe I allow my fear of going out and praising and worshiping with the body to keep me in isolation. And that's exactly what happened to this servant. Because of his fear, he said he was afraid. He and his talent lived in isolation. What happens to this kind of servant? He is replaced. His talent, his blessing, is taken away and is given to someone else who isn't going to hide it and who is going to use it for others. We're going to go back to Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 22, we're in verse 20 now. Only two more verses, well, three more verses left. He says, "In that day I will call my servant Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, and I will clothe him with your robe. I will replace you. And will bind your sash on him. I will replace you. And will commit your authority to his hand. I will replace you. And he shall be a father to the inhabitants of Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. I will bless him. And I will place on his shoulder the key of the house of David." Here we are, that language. "He shall open and none shall shut, and he shall shut and none shall open." There's that language again. Doors and opening and shutting and keys. What does it mean? What do we see here? Well, to the one who stewards his authority well, to the one who uses his kingdom resources, uses the resources of the kingdom that God has given that person, the one who uses those resources to bless the kingdom, to the one who shepherds the flock, pastors the people, and blesses the unfortunate, that one, that person gets the master key. Because God rewards those who bless others. Your blessings and your resources do not belong to you. They come down from the Father of lights. Your talents, your passions, and your purpose are a gift from God that you are meant to share with others. I feel like a dad right now, like a parent. Hey, little Johnny, you need to share. You need to share. And like I said, our God is a good, good Father. And I think he reminds us that we need to share. I want to add to this, And I know I've belabored this whole point with a ton of scripture. I know that we've already talked about a ton of scripture, but we still got some scripture left. And I need you to understand this fully, that your talents, passions, resources, and purpose do not belong to your individual ministry, okay? You can bring a lot of people to Christ alone, and that's great. Like, we are supposed to go out, and I want you to change your world. I want to change my world too, but this is not just about how many people you individually can share God's kindness with. This is about God's church. God is judging and God is evaluating his churches as a whole. Acts chapter 2, verses 44 through 47 says, "And all who believed were together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved." Your blessings also belong to God's church. This isn't my church. This isn't Pastor Jeff's church. This is God's church. And we are to gather, be generous, and be glad. I hope you've noticed this, because God doesn't compliment Philadelphia for their individual prayer lives. He doesn't commend them because they were individually generous with their resources. He commends them because this body of believers held fast to the name of God, kept his word, and did not deny his name. God doesn't give this kind of a blessing to a church that only thinks about themselves. God doesn't give this kind of letter to a church that only thinks about the needs of other people and never addresses the needs of the body right there in the church. God doesn't give this kind of blessing that we see in this letter to people whose walk with God is just reading their Bible and dedicating a closet in their house for prayer. I'm not trying to call anybody out here. I'm not thinking of anybody when I say this. But God doesn't give these kinds of blessings to people who only focus on one of these three things. God gives this kind of blessing to churches that love God, love each other, and love the world. Jesus told the church in Philadelphia, "You have kept my word, you have not denied my name. You have kept my word on patient endurance." But I think the best encouragement that he gives in the whole scripture is what we're going to talk about right now. Revelation chapter 3, verse 9. He says, "Behold, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say that they are Jews and are not, but lie. Behold, I will make them come and bow down before your feet, and they will learn that I have loved you." That is victory. It's triumph. It's not the kind of victory that has our enemy as our footstool. No, it's not the victory that kills our enemy and whirls him round and round like a ball and then throws him into a field. It's not that kind of victory. God is telling this church that their enemies will be humbled and they will finally understand and know the love that God has for his people. God is telling this church he's going to answer their prayers. They kept his word. They fought the fight. They stewarded their blessings. They didn't concede to the culture. Now God blesses them by adding to their numbers and saving their friends, their family, and their community. God is giving them an open door so that more might know the name of Jesus and call him Lord. That's the blessing that keeps on giving. They were faithful with what they had, and now God gives them more. More, more, and more names in the book of life. Salvation. And I think that when we really look at this church in context of these letters, what we see is that what Philadelphia had in spades was what Ephesus had lost. And what the other churches that we've talked about This idea was far in the rearview mirror for them. What did Philadelphia do? They loved. I'm going to read another scripture. I know there's a lot of them. Is it okay to read the Bible on a Sunday morning? Is it okay to read the Bible in a message? Matthew chapter 2, chapter 22, verses 35 through 40 says, "And one of them, a lawyer, asked Jesus a question to test him. Teacher, what is the great commandment in the law? And he said to him, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment.'" And you know how Jesus is, you know. We ask for one thing and he gives us blessings and then keeps giving us more and more blessings. He says, the second is like it. "You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets." God gave us the greatest blessing of all, his love. Do we hide it? Do we fear what we might do with it? Do we fear what might happen when we contradict the culture for it? Do we keep it to ourselves, basking in the love and basking and soaking in the presence of God, but never sharing with the world and never bringing it to the world, never bringing it even to church? I think Philadelphia brought the love of God to their church and to their world. I think Philadelphia was a testament to its own name. It's the city of brotherly love. Why didn't the church receive a correction? I guess that's what I've been asking this whole time. Why didn't they? The answer was hiding under our nose the whole time. It's in their name. Their name was love. And their name was alive because their love was alive. It wasn't cold. It wasn't dead. How's your love doing? John chapter 13, verse 35 says, "By this everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." That's not a given. God says, if you love one another, don't let your love grow cold. Don't be isolated. Don't hide your talents away. Take your talents, invest them in people, and multiply the kingdom of God. Love your brothers, Philadelphia. Love your sisters. Preach the gospel and don't forsake God's word. It's the recipe for success in the kingdom of God, and it's a guaranteed formula for open doors that no one shuts and closed doors that no one opens. Thank you so much for joining us today. And if this was your first time, I want to ask you to go to our website, hit the Connect tab, and fill out the prompts because we would love to talk to you. If maybe this is your first time with us, we want to put resources in your hands. We want to love on you. We want to pray for you. We want to talk with you. And I cannot wait to see all of you here next time, new, old, as we end this powerful series talking about the church in Laodicea. Cannot wait to see you then. God bless you and have a great week.